Good, good. You have good holidays? Yeah, some of you did, some of you didn't. Yeah, mine was a mixed bag. I'm kind of in a whirlwind today. I have family that came in. I went to see some family. I've got more family coming in this afternoon, and tucked in the middle of it, I had to drive to Brownwood, Texas yesterday for a funeral. And so it's kind of been a real weird kind of holiday for me, but I'm glad to be here with you. I always enjoy coming to the Brook and seeing you guys and being able to speak here, and it's good to be here today. I want to talk to you today about the way of Jesus. And we're in church, and that's pretty kind of a natural thing to talk about, right? But I want to talk to you because I think often we get confused, and it's almost as if those of us that are Christians, we it's almost as if we even become a religion rather than realizing that Jesus came to lead us in a way of life. Do you know, and probably most of you have heard this, but the first followers of Jesus were called people of the way. Did you know that? That's what they were called before they were ever called Christians. They were people of the way. They were people of the way of Jesus. And in other words, Jesus didn't come to establish a new religion. Jesus came with a way of living, a way of being, a way of connecting with God. And I think today maybe we have wandered from the way a little bit, and we've lost our way. Even though we would say we're Christians, I think in the midst of that sometimes have lost this idea that it is a way of being and it is a way of living. And so that's what I want to talk to you about today. Even after, I mean, they first called them Christian or the people of the way, and then they started calling them Christians. And when they used the word Christian, even it was a derogatory term. And they say, oh, look at those little Jesuses. Look at those little Christ people. Look at those little followers of Jesus. In other words, the followers of Jesus looked like Jesus. And here's the challenge I want to give you today, folks. I think there is a growing number of people in our American culture that are turned off by the Christian church because there are way too many people in the church that call themselves Christians that really aren't following the way of Jesus. Now, I don't want this to be a negative message, but I just want to say that to you to hopefully help you today to see, well, let's ask and answer the question, what then is the way of Jesus? So that if I've gotten out of alignment, I can be back in alignment. And I want us to look at a little story in Luke chapter 9. So if you have a Bible and you want to look there, I'm going to read out of a really new translation called The Voice. And this is the Luke section. And let me just, it's in Luke chapter 9, beginning in about verse 54, if you want to follow along there. And the first part of the story I want to tell you, and then I'm going to read the rest, okay? The first part of the story is it's a period when Jesus and his disciples are about to head down to Jerusalem, where the end of Jesus' ministry is going to happen. He's going to die and be crucified and all of that. And they begin to head that way. And as they head that way, Jesus sends a couple of his disciples out in front of him to prepare these towns that he's coming to for his arrival, to make arrangements where they're going to stay and all that kind of thing. And the disciples go to a town that is a Samaritan town. Now, I need to just help you understand and remember that the Samaritans were the hated enemies of the Jewish people. And they were because they were considered kind of sellouts and half-breeds. And the Samaritans hated the Jews and the Jews hated the Samaritans. It's kind of like, you know, there's lots of football going on and tons of big rivalry games. And, you know, if you're a part of any of those rivalries, one team hates the other, right? Well, this was way beyond that. They literally hated one another. And in their hate for one another and despising of one another, they didn't want anything good to happen to anybody. And it was built into their culture. And I think one of the things we need to be careful of is who we hate, okay? But they were that way. And so Jesus is coming along and he sends his disciples ahead and they go into the Samaritan village and they say, you know, this one that is the Messiah is come and he's beyond all religion and he's beyond all culture and we want you to listen to him. Would you welcome him? And the Samaritans in the village, when they heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem, which is the religious heart of Judaism, they said, we don't want any part of him. No, you can't come to our town. He's not welcome here. And two of the disciples, James and John, now, those guys were fishermen, and they also are called, do you know what who they are sons of? James and John, the sons of thunder. That's what their dad was called, thunder. What kind of a personality do you think he had? He clouded up and rained a lot, right? He's and these guys are the sons of thunder. And so the sons of thunder, I think probably, you know, were a little volatile themselves and kind of like dad. And so they go into this town and the Samaritans say, Jesus isn't welcome here. Don't come into our town. And the sons of thunder go back and report it to Jesus. And they say, they wouldn't welcome us in the town. So now, would you like us to call down fire from heaven and just annihilate them? Now, folks, they were serious. That's what they wanted to happen. Now, where in the world they get off thinking they could call down fire from heaven, I don't know. But they thought they could, and they threatened to kill the Samaritans. And Jesus said, no, 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 no. You guys don't get it. That's not what I'm about. I'm here to help people. I'm not here to hurt people. I'm here to welcome people. I'm not here to repel people. And even if they reject me, I'm not rejecting them. Okay? So that's kind of the context. And then immediately following that, in chapter 9, we have the rest of the story. Jesus then, he led them on toward another village. That's verse 56 and verse 57. Farther along on the road, a man volunteered to become a disciple of Jesus. And he volunteered and he said, I'll follow you and go to any destination you want me to go to. And Jesus looked at the man and said, foxes are at home in their burrows and birds are at home in their nests, but the Son of Man has no home. And then he looked at another person. He said, you, I want you to follow me. And the other person said, well, I'll be glad to, teacher, but first let me go attend to my father's funeral. And it wasn't that his father was already dead. He said, let me wait until my parents die. You know, I can't quite get to it yet, was what he was saying there. And then Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. I'm giving you a different calling to go and proclaim the kingdom of God. And that calling is still for us today. That's what we as followers are called to do, proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God. And then there was a third volunteer who said, I'll come, Jesus, I'll follow you, but just let me first go home and say goodbye to my family. Now, this is Thanksgiving time, and there's a lot of family related to that. I mean, you and I can identify with that, right? Yeah, let me just go home and say goodbye. Let me just go home and, you know, make sure things are in order with all my family. And Jesus said, listen, if your hand is on the plow, but your eyes are looking backwards, then you're not fit for the kingdom of God. Or if you're reading the NIV version, it says you're not fit for service in the kingdom of God. Well, those are some challenging words about discipleship and about what it means to follow the way of Jesus. And I want to kind of pull from that five things that I think will help us understand what the way looks like. Maybe some things that the way isn't, and then some things that the way is. First of all, I want you to notice, based on that story of the sons of thunder, that the way of Jesus is not the way. It's not the way of violence and destruction. That's not the way of Jesus. Now, I want to say that, and that verse and that I wanted to include it in the story because I've got a deep concern today that far too many Christians are angry and they want to retaliate and blow somebody up. And I don't think that's the way of Jesus. What I mean by that is, you know, our country has enemies, and I'm patriotic, and I believe in being a good American and all of those kinds of things. But we as followers of Jesus don't need to be proponents of hate. Jesus said that we're to love our enemies and we're to pray for those that are that come against us. And I'm not just talking about those that are against our country. It seems to me that we live in a time, and in fact, former President Jimmy Carter said it. He said, we're living in days when America, the American people, are as divided as the people were in the Civil War. We're just as divided as people were then. And what I see among many of us who say that we're followers of Jesus, and it's so easy to get caught up in that, is that we get in this division, and if we don't agree with what somebody else who is a countryman of ours believes in, if they support a political party different than ours, or if they support a political candidate different than ours, or if they support an issue that's different than ours, then it's okay to be hateful. And I want to tell you, as followers of Jesus, it's not okay to be hateful. Can I hear an amen there? It's not okay. And I want to encourage us to stand up as followers of the way and say, that is not the way of Jesus. Now, I'll tell you how hard this is, because how many of you get those forwarded emails all the time with somebody, with all kinds of junk in them? I do too. Well, let me tell you, the other day I got one from my mother. My nice, lovely, Christian, 80-year-old mother. And she sends me one of these forwards that just was unbelievable, and it was spewing hatred for somebody. And I said, what am I going to do? I mean, when I read it, I instantly said, oh my gosh, here's another one. And so I had to write an email back to my mother and basically tell her I thought she was out of line. Now, that's uncomfortable to do. What I'm saying to you, folks, is could one or two of us, could all of us in the room begin to declare that we're gonna say no to hate, and we're gonna say no to slander and gossip and all the junk that comes? Because you know what we do? We get just like James and John, don't we? And we say, well, Lord, would you just call fire, blow them up, send them to hell, whatever. And Jesus says, that's not my way. That's not the way I do it. That's not the way I do business. My way is not the way of hatred, of violence, and destruction. Even if it's a political enemy, don't hate them. That's probably my big soapbox today, okay? So we'll move on. You ready? Anybody with me there? Good. Secondly, my way is not the way of ease and comfort and safety. Do you notice that in the story? The first guy says, I'll go with you anywhere. And Jesus says, well, what you need to know is everybody's got a home except for me. And if you're going to follow me, you need to know that I may ask you to go somewhere that's uncomfortable. I may ask you to do something that's not what you normally would do. And following my way, that's the way it is. And when I first read that, you say, well, I don't want to do anything that is uncomfortable, right? I don't want to do anything that isn't easy and isn't comfortable and isn't safe. And yet what Jesus calls us to is he calls us into a way that is a way of adventure. And when you're along the way of adventure, it involves maybe some things that are uncomfortable or risky or not safe. This funeral that I went to yesterday and that I actually helped officiate was of a friend of mine that I've known for the last probably 36, 7 years. He and I met when we were teenagers, and we met because we were both involved in doing summer missions work where we traveled around
the state of Texas and really around the U.S., and we worked in summer camps all summer long, and each week we'd be in a different camp, and we would do all sorts of things, but primarily we would do the spiritual emphasis things of youth camps and children's camps and all those kinds of things. So can you imagine when I was 16, 17, and 18, I did it for three summers, that we'd travel around, do all that as these young men, and what we were a part of is we were invited into the adventure of joining God in His mission in the world. And as a young teenager, we learned and we were included in that. Now, I want to tell you, we didn't always know where we were going to sleep. We didn't always know how we were going to get from one place to the other. We had really, really, really long days. I mean, there were all kind of inconvenience in it, but you know how much that bothered us? Absolutely not an inch, not a smidgen at all. Why? Because we were involved in this thing that God had invited us into to join Him in. And it was an adventure. And so the way of Jesus may not be the way of ease and comfort and safety, but it is the way of an adventurous life. It's the way to not be bored. It's the way to get out of just being religious and find that there is this adventure that God wants to invite you into if you'll just connect with Him. It is a way of being. That's two. Now three. This way of Jesus, my way, Jesus would say, is not a system of belief. It's a way of life. And you and I have talked about that here. We've talked about this difference between a system of belief and a way of life. But notice what Jesus said to the second man. He looked out. Now, it'd be like me walking up the aisle. This will wake a few people up, see, if I walk out here. I want you to follow me.
You got it.
All right, you're coming, yeah. That's what Jesus said. He looked at this guy. I want you to follow me. You know, it's like Uncle Sam pointing the finger at you. Well, how am I going to say no to that? Well, what he's saying is, I want you to follow me. Now, notice the language. He did not say, I want you to believe in me. Do you notice that? He didn't say, I'm asking you to believe in me. He said, I want you to follow me. I want you to go where I go. I want you to do what I do. I want you to teach what I teach. That's what I'm inviting you into. It's a way of being. It's a way of life. Now, notice also, the word follow implies what? Anybody got an idea? Just guess. Action. Yeah, it implies movement. What's interesting to me is how often, and in fact, I'm doing kind of an informal study on it, how often that within Scripture, God talks about something about as you go, on the way, on your journey, going from here to there. It's almost as if God always speaks to us in movement. And that movement is not, well, just get up and be busy. That movement is, as I'm hearing from God and as I'm journeying with God, it's in those moments that God will teach me and God will speak to me. And so Jesus invites us to follow, to be in the journey, to be along the way with Him. And so I want to say, if you're stuck in the mud, then you're not following because you're stuck somewhere. And that doesn't mean, okay, He wants you to sell your house and get up and move somewhere. He may mean that, but it simply means that in your daily living, you're on this journey with God. And as you're on the journey with God, God will speak to you. Now, here's a key component. You've got to learn to listen to the voice of God. Because as you're journeying, God's voice will guide you along the way to help you know how to keep going along the way. And what's interesting about the disciples is that they were following, but how often were they not listening? You know, Jesus, you don't get it. I mean, even James and John right here, guys, you're not listening to me. My way is not that way. My way is a way of love and mercy and grace. And they didn't get it. But we need to learn to listen along the way. A fourth thing about the way of Jesus. Jesus would say, my way is not bad news. It's good news. It's good news. And somehow, folks, we've lost that. I don't know where, but somehow we've lost it in our American culture that it is good news, this way of Jesus. Now, religion may not be good news, but the Jesus way is good news. It's good news. Now, I'm going to tell you at least two ways that it's good news. The first way is that it's good news because Jesus came welcoming people, not condemning and judging people. Do you notice how often the broken and the marginalized and the disenfranchised and the people that were excluded and were ignored, they all loved being with Jesus. They loved being with Jesus. And what's troubling to me is how often those same kinds of people hate hanging out with Christians. Ouch, right? What's the difference? Why? I don't know all of the answers, but here's what I know about Jesus. Because when Jesus was with them, he was fully engaged and he didn't condemn them or judge them. He was just with them. And as he was with them, he would say, all are welcome, all are forgiven, all are loved, all are welcome to become whole, all are offered grace, everybody. And that's good news, folks. And I'm telling you, there's a lot of hurting people out there who you might, in your deep inner spirit, judge and say, those are not good people, they're sinful people, they're whatever. You can label them with whatever. And as a result, keep them at a distance. But the way of Jesus welcomes those people into your life. And some of those folks, you know, might be your next door neighbor or might even live in your house or might be family members. And so we need to become more like Jesus in that way, and then it becomes a better way. And secondly, the second idea under that about how is this way a better way, how is it good news, it's good news in that he says, I want you to go and preach this good news of the kingdom. And the kingdom, far too much for us to cover today, but it's this agenda of God. And Jesus kept over and over and over again, it says, Jesus went about preaching the good news of the kingdom. And the kingdom was about God's hope and dream for the world and aligning with his agenda in the world. And I think what this text is teaching us is there are a lot of competing agendas out there. You see, even in Jesus' day, Jesus said there are competing religious agendas. And even within the Jewish religion, there were different groups of people. You remember, there were the Pharisees, and there were the Sadducees, and there were the Essenes, and there were the Zealots. And, I mean, there were all these factions, and Jesus said none of them is completely aligned with the agenda of God. So what I want you to do is align with the agenda of God, because none of these other agendas are adequate. And he said the same thing politically. He said, none of these political agendas are adequate. Align with my kingdom. Seek my kingdom agenda first. Seek my way first. And all that other doesn't matter. So I want to say to you, it doesn't matter what political party you affiliate with or what your beliefs are or what TV channel you listen to your news on or what radio shows you listen to. None of those agendas are adequate agendas compared to the kingdom agenda of Jesus. So make that your first priority. And as you do, then these other agendas are less significant and less important. And the way of Jesus gets elevated. The kingdom agenda of God gets elevated. And as we do, we understand then that the way of Jesus is a better way. And I believe that, folks. The more I look at, the more I understand, the more I really focus on the way of Jesus, the more I'm attracted to it. The more I say, that's the way I want to live. It's not just some system of belief. It's not just me quoting four scriptures and asking you to pray at the end. It's a way of being. It's a way of life that is a better way of life, because it's a way of life that matches the character and the nature of God. All right. You're still here. Anybody need a break? Let's pause 1 or 2 seconds for a commercial. Anybody got one? What are you selling? All right. Back to our featured program. Jesus says, number 5, this Jesus way. My way is not a way to be put off or to be neglected. But my way is a way. There's this sense in these stories of discipleship of urgency and importance. The last little story that he said is, you know, this guy came and said, well, let me first go home and say goodbye to family and all of that. And Jesus used this little story. If a man puts his hand to the plow and looks back, he's not worthy of serving in the kingdom. Okay? I've heard that preached a number of times over my life, and it was always about, well, when you choose to become a follower of Jesus, you can't look back and regret all the stuff you had to give up to come follow Jesus. That's the way it was always preached. As I study this and as I'm looking at it, I don't think that's what he's talking about here. Any of you ever done any plowing? Anybody? Yeah, there's a plower. Okay, you and me, brother. I did too. I grew up in the country, all right? And my dad grew up actually farming. He grew up on a cotton farm. And so when he started raising kids, he wanted us to know how to get our hands dirty, right? And so every year, we would plant about a 3-acre garden. Now, that's a pretty good size garden, 3 acres, right? And so, remember now, he's busy working, and so he's got a bunch of kids, and so it was our job to get the garden prepared. And so, you know, if you know anything at all about farming, you know, you disc the field at the end of the season to turn the soil up and get it ready. And then the plowing, for us anyway, the plowing was when you made rows, okay? You came and you plowed up the dirt, and you formed it into rows, so that then you could come behind that and plant the seeds, right? Now, we were fortunate. We had a little tractor, and we had the implements on the back, and so we had a disc, and we had a plow, and we had a planter. And my job was to you know, run the tractor. I was the oldest son. And so, you know, when the time came, I was supposed to go and plow the field. And when you plowed it, you were making these rows, preparing to plant. And for whatever reason, my dad loved planting corn. We always had tons of corn and these long rows of corn. Now, here's the deal. While you're making those rows, my dad taught me and said, now, son, what you want to do is you want to pick a spot down the end of the row down there. And you want to keep your eye on that, okay? And you want to drive the tractor straight forward toward it. And when you do, what that'll do is what? It'll make a straight row. Now, he said, if you go to looking around, or if you turn and start looking backward, you know what's going to happen? That tractor's going to wiggle like a snake. Exactly. Now, here's the problem. I don't know if I have ADD or what, but it's, you know, it's hard for me to just be out there on a tractor and stay really focused, okay? Now, what made it worse for me is across the pasture from us, I could look over, while I was out there plowing, I could look across the pasture, and there was this house about, you know, I don't know how far it was away, but it was over there, and the prettiest girl in my class lived in that house. Yeah, exactly. Somebody's laughing. Are you laughing? Yeah. So, you know, I'm driving along, and I'm looking over there, and I'm saying, man, and I'd start daydreaming, you know, about, boy, I wish the prettiest girl in the class would, you know, date me. Or, you know, I mean, it never happened, but I could daydream, right? And so it was, you know, what my point is? My point is it was easy to get distracted from plowing. Jesus said, once you get, let's paraphrase it, once you get on the tractor, and you're plowing a row, don't look back. Because if you look back or if you look around, you're going to get distracted from the task that I want you to be a part of. And the task that I'm asking you to do is I'm asking you to serve the kingdom agenda. And there's lots of good things to think about. There are many things that are good things that could get your attention and pull you away. But what I want you to do is to give your complete and undivided attention to serving the kingdom in your family, in your neighborhood, on your job, in your community, in all of the activities of life. You see, you don't have to give up all those things. You simply have to serve the kingdom agenda in the midst of all those things. And as you do, you're following His way. So let me just mention a couple of those and then I'm going to be done. I think the serving the kingdom agenda is about being compassionate and extending mercy to the people that God brings into our life. And so we need to be aware of those people. How often in Scripture does it say, do you see this person? And we need to see the people that God brings into our life. I think the way of Jesus and serving the kingdom agenda is about even courageously acting to speak out against injustice in our society. Because Jesus and His way and the kingdom agenda and serving the kingdom is about making sure that everybody in our world gets treated fairly. That's the way of Jesus. Okay? I think it's about helping people be restored to wholeness. We talked about that some a few other times when I was here. It's about working to make the world a better place. One person at a time, with the people that God brings into our life. Now, all of that's kind of big and broad, and you say, how in the world am I going to do that? Well, I want to give you just one simple thing to do as we go today, okay? To serve the agenda of Jesus and to follow His way. And that is, I think, one of the greatest ways that we can serve the people that are already in our life is by learning to listen deeply. And so your assignment as you go today, if you choose to accept it, is to listen deeply to at least one person in your life, hopefully today, but at least this week, and learn to make that a practice in your life. You know, I asked this question. I was talking about this subject to my group at my congregation the other day, and I asked them, how many of you really feel like that you're listened to deeply? And nobody raised their hand in our room. You know, when we listen to one another deeply, what we do is we say, I see you as a person. I hear you as a person. I want to know you as a person. And so I want to invite you to try that out. Maybe you can try it out with your spouse. And once you pick them back up off the floor, maybe, you know, y'all can have a good conversation, right? But listen deeply. Listen deeply to a stranger. One of the things that I encourage you, I want to ask you to try this as well. Maybe you could do this week. As you're standing in line in some of your shopping, which you're going to do, just really listen to and engage in conversation the person behind the register. Look into their eye and ask them how their day's going and what's going on in their life. And just listen. Just that simple thing, and I promise you, you'll make the world a better place. Mother Teresa said this. She said, we can do no great things, just small things with great love. We can do no great things, just small things, with great love. I think that's the way of Jesus. I want to invite you into the greatest way of living, I believe, that there is. It's the way Jesus lived. It's the way He invites us to live. So, live the way of Jesus, the Jesus way. Let's pray.